Roberts. I'm the president of Penn State Prime. I would just like to thank you all for coming out and supporting our efforts in including more branding, media, marketing, and analytics into the Penn State SMEAL curriculum. I just want to remind you that there will be a reception following this panel on the third floor terrace in the business building. We have provided food and drinks for you all and mingling amongst our lovely panelists who have taken the day out. And that is sponsored by Eagle Pharmaceuticals, which Sherry is here supporting them. So without further ado, I'm going to pass it over to Timmy Gard, who is from Love Lane, and we'll get started with the panel. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Is this on? Can everybody hear? Okay. So there was this movie many years ago, I just thought about it. It's called Sabrina. Harrison Ford was in it, and I forget who the actress was. And there's a famous line in the movie. The movie was, this is my first time for everything. And the reason why I say that is because this is the first of what the SMEAL Alumni Society Board and Jen and her group are trying to do. As part of the SMEAL Alumni Board, we want to make sure all the students get real-world applicability of what's happening in the marketplace, whether it's a private company, a publicly held company, an international company, global, a startup, and in the industry. So we're trying to do some creative and innovative new approaches. I lecture, guest lecture twice a year working with Jen, and we talk about some new things. So we kicked this idea around in June, actually started in April, about what if we got a panel together of experts, to help us talk about a specific subject that would resonate with what your learnings are. So we tackled the subject of branding. But before we get to that, I really want to introduce the folks who are going to be doing most of the talking tonight. And they are from right to left, David Lane. He's my boss too, so be nice. Clap when I go like that. He's the CEO of Love Lane Advertising, 34-year-old agency, independent agency in Philadelphia. And he graduated when?
1967.
Okay. Sherry Krasinski, who is the senior vice president of Eagle Pharmaceuticals, a specialty pharmaceutical company, a publicly held traded company. And she also graduated from SMEAL when?
1991.
Nick Baer, who is the CEO of Saxby's. He didn't go to Penn State, so I'm not going to ask you that question. Katie Ambrose from employee brand manager from Unilever. I don't believe you went to Penn State either.
I did not.
But Lee Myers from Jane Gerald and Mooncare went to Penn State and graduated from
2004.
Okay. So we have some smart folks here. Trust me, they did. What we're going to do is I'm going to start off by asking some questions, and then we have an hour, and maybe the last 5 or 10 minutes we'll let some of you ask a question or two. Does that sound good? So branding, right, means so many different things. I'm just going to read a couple things to you to get this thing going, okay? This is a definition from Wikipedia. What is a brand? A brand is a set of marketing communication methods that help to distinguish and create a lasting impression in the minds of customers. It's another definition. A unique design, sign, symbol, words, or a combination of these employed in creating an image that identifies a product or service that differentiates it from its competition. Or a type of product or service manufactured or created by a particular company under a particular name. Or creating a specific perception in customers' eyes of distinguishing the qualities and attributes, each in non-generic form. Which one is correct? Somebody raise their hand. What is your name?
Max.
Where are you from?
I'm from originally New Orleans, Louisiana. I'm from Landenburg, Pennsylvania now.
You're not a Saints fan, are you?
I am a Saints fan.
I'm going to call on somebody else. That's it. Which answer is correct?
All of the above.
Damn right they are. Branding is feeling, it's a gut. It's not necessarily a product, or it could be a product. But you know what? We're going to find out what these folks have to say. So, here's the first question. Dave, happens to come to you. What's the process of brand development at your agency? And how do you define success?
Thank you, Timmy. And thank you, everyone. I'm happy to be here. And yes, I did graduate all those years ago. I was not in marketing and business, but I was in journalism, operating out of the old Carnegie building on the mall. And I had a great education here. Well, the branding process at Lead Lane, I could speak a couple of ways on that. First of all, we are advocates of developing strong brands for our clients. We first start with our own business, Lead Lane, an agency about 65 folks in downtown Philadelphia. And we have established a brand persona that works for us at our organization. And that is the simple phrase, who loves you? Who loves you? And this is the phrase that we ask our clients to ask themselves and their employees and staff about who loves them as their business. Who are their customers? Who are the people that they cherish and they love? And those are the folks that we focus on from a brand development standpoint for our clients. The way our process is very similar to a process that any organization would go through. When we win a piece of business, we get very, very deeply involved in that business. We interview everybody we possibly can. Just like perhaps when you're developing a campaign or you're developing a paper or a point of view, you go out and you do research. You may be standing on College Avenue asking questions of students that go by. You may be interviewing your professors. You may go try to find customers in stores. Well, that's what we do. That is part of our process. So for a client, what we do is we interview a one-on-one. Many times we record the interview and we talk about that particular brand. Who are you? Who are your customers? What do they stand for? What's your point of difference? What makes you special? How are you better than your competition? Where do you see yourself in 5 years? If you were an animal, what would you be? And so forth and so on. And after possibly as many as 40 or 50 of these interviews, we pulled the input together and we develop a positioning of what we think we have heard the interviewee saying about their company or customers saying about their company. And then we develop that positioning, we present it to our clients, and sometimes we present advertising along with it, and sometimes we just talk about the positioning line, if it fits, does it make sense, does it conform to the business now, how about 10 years from now? So that's the process that we use in developing brands for our clients, Tim.
Wait, J&J is a big company. It's got many different subsidies, many different business units. I used to work with J&J in communications, so I'm a little familiar about their approach, but talk to us about the same answer to that question.
Sure, not sure how recently you worked with J&J, but I say over the last 3 years we've really grown up in terms of, you know, how we go about building our brands. You guys might be surprised to hear that up until recently, J&J's actually hasn't done a good job as we'd like to of building our brands globally. So lots of the brands that you guys are probably having in your, you know, kitchens and bathrooms back at home, and your dorm rooms, you know them pretty well in the U.S., but you'd be really surprised what they might look like and feel like in other parts of the world. So we were lucky to hire our first chief marketing officer. Her name's Allison Lewis. She joined about 3 years ago from Coca-Cola, and she helped institute a global brand building, a new global brand building process that we use consistently around the world, across every one of our brands, so that we're taking a really standard approach. It's a six-step process. I'll sort of really briefly talk through it. But first and foremost, it starts with our brand spotlight and really a look internally at, for whatever brand and that we're speaking of. It's really a look at what does the brand stand for, what are the brand assets, who are the champions of the brand, and ultimately what's the promise and values that we want to deliver in everything that we do and say develop. So it's a good sort of foundation of what the brand stands for. That then the second allows us to take the second step, which is around the growth plan. So, you know, once we've defined who we are and what we're going to be about, how are we going to actually approach that from a business standpoint? And go out and identify where we're going to play, how we're going to play and win there, which product segments, what types of products are we going to launch, are we trying to get new users, are we trying to get existing users to purchase more. So being really clear about the brand, the steps to growth of how we're actually going to go about building our brand in different geographies and categories. And then with that, once we've identified what the brand's about and you know where we're going, how we're going to grow, is when we then start to think about how we bring the brand to life. And it's really about through a universal and global big idea. And so, you know, for every one of the, we have 13 mega brands at J&J now, we have developed global campaign ideas of what the brand stands for, which is the external expression of how we actually go out and communicate, you know, our point of view and as a brand, but also the messages, both emotional and functional, that help us actually go about and achieve the brand growth plan that we've identified. So once we have the idea, then it becomes about how do we get that idea out there. And so connections planning becomes a big piece of that, and that's where we think about where do consumers that use our brand, where do they actually intersect? Where are they in their day as they're going about their journey, whatever category or franchise it might be in? And we think about the connection points, whether it's you know the drive into work or the coffee store that they stop in on the way, or the moment when they're kissing their children to go to sleep. We think about all those points of connections, and then like, we prioritize the ones that we think mean the most of where we as a brand can actually show up with that big idea and connect with that consumer. That's connections planning. Then it comes down to actual development of our advertising materials, our content development. And so, you know, whether it's a print ad or a radio spot or a television commercial or a YouTube series, all of the actual development of the content that consumers actually will interact with. And then we actually deploy it, we track it, we measure it, and we see its effectiveness. So, you know, that's sort of how we go about now consistently across every one of the big brands. At J&J, obviously the nuances in a category and who the target are quite different from brand to brand, but that's the process that we take to put that brand to brand.
Great. Sherry.
Timmy.
Not a shot. What are the important factors in brand development? Is it the right copy? Is it the content? Is it the creative? Is it the media channel? Is all of it? What are they? And how do you determine what they are?
Well, I think it's dependent on the product and the life cycle of the product. I think, you know, your messaging clearly has to be defined, right? So I think we've already talked about, you know, your positioning. And once your positioning is defined, we talked about where you are on the brand ladder, you do the connections plan and meet your customer where they are. So to me, it's hard to say what is more important. It's like the chicken or the egg, right? If you can have the most creative message in the world, but if it does not resonate with your customer at the right time and at the right place, it's irrelevant. So you have to make sure that it's all tied together. And so I would say all of the above.
Okay. Nick, what's the difference between marketing and branding?
Thought we were friends.
I moved that question up earlier, so I couldn't wait anymore.
Yeah, wow, Timmy. You told us you guys have bombs to drop. I didn't realize it would be that early. Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here and to be on such an esteemed panel. I run a hospitality business in the coffee industry, as we like to say. It's based in Philadelphia. So this won't be a circuitous answer. I promise I'll try to answer that question. But We see ourselves as just that. We see ourselves as a people business, not a product business. We're in a really competitive industry. Just like everybody up here, you know, there's a lot of companies out there that sell great coffee and make great scones and make great muffins. And what I love might be very different than what David loves. And so we look at product in our industry as something that's very subjective. We look at human experience as something that's very objective. Regardless of whether you're 18 or 55, whether you're rich or poor, you're educated, you're not educated, we all want to be treated well. And so we're in the business of treating people well. And we define a culture based on that. So our brand is actually a culture-based brand. So we don't hire people on whether they know what an espresso machine is or a brewer. We hire them based on their personality. They wake up every single day with a smile on their face, looking to make an impact in someone's life. where they wake up and kick their cat and say something mean to their neighbor. Doesn't necessarily make them a bad person, probably doesn't make them a great person either, but they're not gonna necessarily be a culture fit for us. And so for us to compete and be a brand that is based on culture and a brand that is based on hospitality and treating people well, we have to hire people that are like-minded to that brand. So that's what brand is for us. I see marketing as the function of proliferating that brand. So marketing is our ability to be able to align our social media, be able to align our sampling, be able to align all the efforts that we put into opening up a new cafe, or a third of my locations, about 15 of my locations are on or adjacent to college campuses. So this demographic in this room is the majority of who we serve. So every single semester, when Temple goes back to school, or Drexel goes back to school, or Penn goes back to school, eventually when Penn State goes back to school, we treat each new semester as a new opportunity, a new beginning, as if we just opened up that cafe, because there's a lot of change on college campuses. So marketing is the effort that we actually put forth to be able to proliferate our brand. So that's the way that we look at the difference between marketing and branding at Zaxby's. You might want to give it to the smarter Penn State graduates.
Kate, do you
want to
answer that as well?
Sure. Nick
looked a little nervous, so I got you.
I have the employer brand functions. It's a little bit different from traditional brand development. Do you guys know about employer branding? Does anybody know? I believe that because I just tried to hire two and I couldn't. I had to steal them from other companies. So employer branding really has to do with selling your company to, kind of to your point, the person who is going to be the right fit to come and join that culture, to contribute to that culture, to contribute to building the things that you need to build. So when we think about employer brand at Unilever, a lot of times what we would try to do in the past was hope that people understood who we were as a brand through the halo effect of having brands like Dove or Axe, even though they didn't really represent who we were as an employer brand culture. They were great brands that people, billions of people, used all over the world every single day, doing really amazing work. But it didn't help people understand how we actually were as an internal company culture. So it didn't necessarily make us more attractive as an employer. So we actually had to think about our brand as the story that we tell to people through our employees, through the work that we do, and trying to make that as transparent as possible, so that people come and see who we really are. Not just, we have Dove, that's great. Oh, I like Vaseline, let me go work there. It was more about, here are these amazing things we do, here's how much we care about sustainability through our USLP, which is our sustainable living plan. But then, that was great, we had all these great stories, we were really starting to try to think more about our employer brand and make that a lot more concise and less about our company brands. But then the marketing actually is how we get that now to you. So that's what we're actually building now. It's a branding function at Unilever. J&J has done it really well for a long time. They always beat us in the rankings every year. But now the marketing is really trying to get that good mix of tactics, so trying to get the good mix of platforms, the right content to the right people at the right time. We traditionally had done a lot of career fairs. It was very specific to certain universities, Penn State being one. Now we're trying to take that out to a wider audience, so really that's the vehicle to get those stories out. The stories are representative of our brand. The marketing is how we get them to you as the talent consumer. I didn't coin that phrase, I'm stealing it. Did that answer the question?
We're all very good. Sherry, how do you use research to measure brand satisfaction? And what types of research do you use?
I really didn't like market research when I was here at Penn State 29 years ago. But, I think research is critically important. When I was here at Penn State, I graduated in 91. It was just becoming the boom of healthcare, right, and pharmaceutical companies. And pharmaceutical companies starting to hire marketing majors, because prior to that, they hired pharmacists to sell drugs. And then, they moved into some other healthcare professionals to be the sales representatives out there. In the early 90s, mid-90s, there was just a boom of the pharmaceutical companies hiring more and more people. More was better. So I was recruited here at Penn State by Eli Lilly and Company. you probably have seen the Cialis commercials on TV with the two bathtubs. But you know, when I started, our big product was Prozac. So that's a great example of a brand that became really a generic name, like Band-Aid, like Kleenex, right? I had the just great fortune of being with Lilly for about 15 years. When I was on the sales side and sales leadership side, you know, our ability to measure was based on how many prescriptions were written, right? How much hospitals purchased. It wasn't really until I moved on to the marketing side about 10 years ago. I left Lilly, I went with another company, Mylan Pharmaceuticals, and we had generic products, pharmaceuticals, and we had some branded pharmaceuticals. And it was there that I really started to understand the critical nature of measuring brand performance. Well, how the heck do you, you know, I really thought, I just measure based on how much sales we're doing. But in all actuality, you know, it's much more complex, as I'm sure you guys have learned in your classes. We do ATUs, attitude, trial, and usage, understanding, we measure, and every 3 to 6 months, we have a set amount, number of questions that we ask our customers. And we, you know, has their awareness of our product, of the disease state, for example, increased? What is their trial been, right? Is their trial increasing? And we base that on the messaging that the salespeople are delivering in the marketplace, that are marketing messages that are going out through CRM, through digital channels, through TV commercials. Is that working, right? And the way we measure, is it working? Hey, is awareness increasing, and by how much? Are people trying it, right? So you kind of think of people that never used it and now they're starting to use it a little bit, and then usage. And so have we taken people that are users and made those users of it or prescribers of it in the pharma world bigger? And so it is how I as a marketer, that's how I'm measured, right? Now ultimately our CEO measures me on revenue and sales, which is the right thing to do, but you know, we are also measured on how we're moving along that curve. So we sit down, we put key performance indicators into place at the beginning of each year based on where we were the previous year, where our revenue targets are, and you know, based on our strat plan, again, that we have worked, you know, 6 months, now is strat plan season, right, starting for January, that we measure ourselves then, put that in place, and then every several months measure ourselves against that. So analytics are critically important. You know, they're leading indicators. So if you think about it, you know, you can put lots and lots of messages out there. So let's just say we launch a TV ad, right? Everybody has seen the drug TV commercials. So I worked on for about 6 years on the brand EpiPen, and we started doing TV commercials on EpiPen when I went into the brand. And we did both branded, right, and unbranded. And the unbranded are disease state awareness. So information about food allergies and anaphylaxis and risk. And so it was real important to measure not only how much EpiPen was growing, but also how much the market was growing. And those were key performance indicators for us that ultimately led to overall sales and revenue performance. So those are just some ways that in my world that we measure ourselves and why analytics are so important.
David, from an agency point of view of working with a variety of different clients and different verticals, we do research all the time. Talk about some of the ways that we do research with our clients, whether it's healthcare, whether it's banking, whether it's B2B, whether it's consumer, whatever it might be, from an agency point of view.
Well, the more you know about your client's business, the smarter you're going to be, and the more you're going to be able to help your clients. So research is very, very important in understanding particular products and particular brands. So yes, we do trial, and we do usage, and we measure competition, and we measure attitudes. But the deeper the dive, the better you're going to be able to serve your clients. The number one thing in terms of research is, to me, sales. That's the number one. Advertising is not a fun thing. You don't do it because you come up with great ideas. You do it because it's an investment and you get a return on your buck. And if you don't get a return on your dollar, then it's money that is really wasted. So sales, number one. So for research, for our clients' businesses, we always want to know, well, how did you do? And sometimes it's, well, how did you do last weekend? And how did you do over Mother's Day? And how did you do over the holiday period? And were sales up? Did you have more people? Were traffic up? Was traffic up this year over last year? Did they spend more money? How did the promotion work that we put in place? So that is just some of the basic kind of research that just comes because we're curious about our clients' business. Some clients are very free to share those numbers, other clients are not. So agencies are left in a position where we sometimes have to guess how our clients are doing. But then there is another kind of research. If you're working in a retail business, if you're working with a lot of licensees or franchisees or bank managers or hospital managers, you go out and talk to them. Hey, we're your advertising agency, and how did you do when we advertised this? Or what, did you have any customers call? Did you get any anecdotal information about programs that we have put in place? So that is also a curiosity kind of research, and it doesn't really cost any money, does it? It's just go out and talk to your customers, or go out and talk to the people that are the regional developers and the regional managers. Then you want to get deeper, and now at Levelane, at least, we hire an outside company to do some deeper dives. So we want to take a look at how, if you are our customer, how you feel about us, but if you are not our customer, why are you not our customer? You are in the demo. You're supposed to be coming to our coffee shop for coffee. Why aren't you doing that? What haven't we done to attract your attention, and why haven't we reached you in the right way? So we go out and we ask, when we maybe ask 300 people, and we have them sorted by demo and certain particular pieces of lifestyle, and then we get that information back, and now we're able to see what progress we have made and where we understand our customers, where we don't understand our customers, and also our competition. Because for every couple of bathtubs, there are other clients that are out there that we see all the time. And for every coffee brand, there's a lot of other coffee brands, and so forth and so on. So we want to know what the other guys are doing. So that curiosity is, know your competition, know their product, know their menu, know it well enough so you can go into your client and say, you know what, I just visited or bought or took a look at, and they are introducing a new way that they are going to market their healthcare business. So have we thought about that? Have you looked into that particular area? So research, curiosity, getting deep down interest in your client's business is the way that you will service them the best way, and it's also the way you'll hold on to their business for a long time.
Thank you. Wait. A couple times a year, I guest lecture at Jim's class in marketing. At every class, I'm asked the same question. How important is gaining sales experience first before getting a marketing role? And I never give the right answer. And I know that I'm going to be lecturing in the spring, so help me out with the answer.
I think it's a great question. And I think to build off of David's point, there's so much that you can learn by talking to the people whose feet are on the ground. And whether that's the operator of a coffee shop or the people that are the sales folks who are out there calling on retail customers, or the people who are working the cash registers at your retail store. Those people are interacting with the people that are ultimately the people that matter to us as branders and as manufacturers. people buying our product are ultimately make the decision, do they believe in the brand that we're trying to create and build or not? And so understanding that perspective of where rubber meets the road is super important. The best, David talked about ways to do that without actually going and opportunistically going about identifying that information, but I actually spent the first 5 years of my career in the sales organization with J&J, where I spent, you know, I was calling on, I lived down in Arkansas, Bentonville, Arkansas for 3 years, spent 3 years calling on the Walmart customer team, and really got a really good understanding of how a retailer, a sophisticated retailer, thinks about helping, working with manufacturers to help grow their brand as a retailer, but also, and through that, how we as a business can grow our brands in the environment in which they're sold. And so, you know, I found that the sales experience of actually being out there where the action's happening, being very customer focused, understanding how, especially in our business where we sell through retailers, how they think, how they make decisions, what's important to them, has allowed us and me specifically as we go and build out our strategies and our new products and our ideas for how we grow our brands in the future. A strategy is only as good as it's able to actually be executed, and I found that the sales experience that I got early on in my career really helped ground a lot of the strategic thinking that drives a lot of what we do now. And so, as an organization, we're really encouraging a lot more of our marketers to get very cross-functional experience. Sales being one of the most important cross-functional experiences to get. So. That's definitely becoming a new and emerging career path for marketers at J&J, and I think at lots of other consumer packaged goods companies, because it's great to have good ideas. It's great to be, you know, really strategic and understand the big picture. So you're, you know, work your way through that whole six-step process I was talking about earlier. But if you don't understand, you know, how a physical package actually shows up on the Walmart shelf and what it takes to get it there, you know, all of that is sort of pointless. And
we talk a lot about culture. Culture being important to a brand, culture being important to a company. These folks that don't have jobs yet will be interviewing. Nick and Katie, both of you. I'm going to put you in the spot, buddy. How do students know whether they are a right culture fit for your company? How do you know that they're a right culture fit? What should they be looking for? Has it all meshed?
Yeah, you know, I think I talked to this a little bit before, so I established the fact that we see ourselves as a culture-driven lifestyle business. That's who we are as a company. If you read any press on our business or if you come into our headquarters, and hopefully if you go into our cafes, you feel that. I think today, as much as any time that I've been on this earth for, at least looking at jobs and careers, you know, I came out of school in 2000 when the really hot thing, if it wasn't pharmaceuticals, was finance. You know, people ran to Wall Street. There's one in 10 jobs that existed when I was coming out of school on Wall Street that exists today. It's a little bit different. And I think the time's a little bit different because your generation is a lot different too. I came out of school, my dad's advice to me was go to the biggest company possible and just climb the ladder. Go as long as it takes to just climb the ladder. And I couldn't have wanted to go the opposite direction more. I just didn't want to do that. You know, I saw, and my dad still sort of does this to this day. And he's got long commutes in both directions, works for a boss he doesn't think cares about him, in an industry he doesn't think he's making an impact on. I want to do something completely different. I want to be able to make an impact in this world. I wanted my headstone to say that I did something professionally that made a difference in this world. So our culture, our mission statement is actually make life better. We have six core values. The word coffee, smoothie, latte isn't in any of them. It's all about human experience. That's how we define culture. So when you walk into my office, it's a humongous open space. It's 10,000 square feet. It's essentially a converted warehouse in downtown Philadelphia. And the first thing you look at is not this massive, really cool training coffee bar. The first thing you see is an 18-foot tall, 46-foot wide wall that was hand-painted by artists in Philadelphia that has our mission core values. So when you walk in, it sets the tone of what our company stands for, but it's also proclaiming out to those that are interested in being connected to that kind of brand. So we want people to walk into our office, they didn't see something before, and say, make life better, or we embrace being outgoing, detailing, and disciplined, which is one of our core values. That's my mission, that's my mission statement, that's my core value. I want to wake up in the morning. That's how you find something you're truly, truly connected to. And so, therefore, our interviewing process isn't that difficult. Most situations, people are showing up now aligned with our brand and aligned with our culture. So when you're looking for jobs, you're really looking for opportunities for your personality traits that fit in and jive with an organization. You should be looking at those things as one and the same. You shouldn't be changing who you are as a human being to fit into a company's culture. And if culture really, really matters to you, make sure it matters to that organization. Every single company that I know has mission core values defined somewhere. It might be on page 900 of their employee handbook, but if you really want to go to a company that truly values culture, they feel like that's their competitive difference, make sure it's not on page 900 of their employee handbook. Make sure it's something that's put out front if that's the type of business that you want to be in. So you have to really, I think, put the employer into the interviewee position a little bit and put them in a position where they're explaining to you, convincing you that they really are a culture-driven business if that's what you're looking to do.
And I think to that point, it has to be consistently put out front. So if you think about the type of company you want to work in, I think you really should take some time to think about it. I mean, really think about it. Because some people are driven by things like maybe they want to join a company and move as quickly as they can, and they want to make a ton of money right out of the gate. But some people want to do something that's maybe more purpose-focused. They don't care so much about, you know, immediate quick income or immediate quick rising. They want to go do something that makes a difference. Like, for example, you just had your mission statement, which is amazing. Ours is also making sustainable living commonplace. So we're looking for people who are passionate about that. But you have to really think about what you want to do and then really take some time, and I cannot stress this enough, but to look for that consistency in an employer that they are saying it, their employees are saying it. Use your peers, use social listening tools, Google Alerts and Hootsuite are a couple free ones, to really kind of listen to that noise that's being made about the company and really try to find out what they're like at their core. Do their employees believe what they're saying? Can you visibly see it? When you go out and look at their profiles on LinkedIn, are they working on things that matter? Is that the kind of culture you want to be aligned with? I think if you look for that consistency and you see it in what the company is saying, what people are saying about the company, Glassdoor is another resource, although people do like to go there and complain. But you can also use to find, I think sometimes don't be scared away by the complaints, because a lot of times that means the company is shifting and they're changing, and there's huge opportunities for you. But one thing that we do at Unilever, because we take this very, very seriously, we try to make sure that we have folks coming in the door that are the right fit. So we actually changed our process this year into an unbiased gamified assessment that actually measures people against profiles that we've built for future skills and future leaders of our company. Because our goal is to actually bring everyone in and convert them from internship into our future leaders program. JJ has a similar one, which is really amazing as well. But we really look for that fit. So we have a tool that we use that actually assesses you for fit. It can tell you if you're the right fit, what your skills are, what your strengths are, or what companies might be a better fit for you if it's not Unilever. So we take that very, very, very seriously. We have to have people in the company that are passionate about our core statement, which is making sustainable living commonplace, and that live that and really believe that every day. So we take that seriously. I think my big advice to you guys is take it seriously. Really, really do a lot of research and think about it.
Good. Thank you. Sure. What are some of the ways that you've been able to make your brand stand out that are different from the competition?
Well, I think you talked about knowing your competition. So first of all, you have to know your competition and know what your strengths and weaknesses are versus your competition. You know, I'm very blessed right now to have started with a new company for me, Eagle Pharmaceuticals, back in January. And, you know, we talk about what is the mission, and I look for people who want to make a difference in people's lives. Most specifically, I want to be able to say I prevented kids from dying, right? And it was something that was ingrained to me when I started in healthcare back in the early 90s. When I took over with EpiPen, my mission statement was there will be no deaths due to anaphylaxis. I've moved over to Eagle, and you know, we are going to be hopefully next summer launching a brand that will, you probably have heard of kids that are on football fields and are athletes that all of a sudden crash and die from exertional heat stroke. And so we will have the first and only pharmaceutical product knock on wood, the FDA, it's always a challenge, but you know, that will treat that. And so for me, it's really important to make sure that, you know, people understand that, you know, again, we're about saving kids and saving people's lives. I think that, you know, ways in which we've made brands stand out, you know, I can go back to EpiPen, and, you know, we really, when you look at the brand ladder, right, how do you get from having being very functional, right, to moving up that ladder to the emotional benefits? And we completely revamped that campaign, and our slogan, our tagline, whatever you want to call it, was "Life happens, be prepared," right? And so no matter where you were, whatever you were doing, whether it's sleepovers happen, be prepared. School happens, be prepared. Summer camp happens, be prepared. The ability to have a campaign that had so many different facets of it, I think was a really, really unique experience that I personally had. It's not often that you do get to work on a product, a service, a business that is like, you know, Kleenex. It has basically, you know, everything is Kleenex, everything is a Band-Aid, everything is Prozac. Well, it didn't matter whether it was, whatever product it was, everybody called it an EpiPen. And so with that, you have good things and bad things come of that, right? But overall, it really allowed us to, and people associated, basically, I saved my kid's life with this. And so there was a huge emotional benefit and emotional tie with the brand. And so we were able to take that, build a massive campaign, multi-channel, multifaceted campaign to make it stand out and be so different.
Thank you. I'm going to ask one more question, and then we're going to turn it over to you folks out there. Lee, it's for you, okay? And the question is, what skills should these folks be looking for in order to develop to be a good brand manager now, or hire up those brand managers?
Sure. So I think there's three things that I guess I would prioritize to be a good marketer, regardless of industry or type of business you work on. One is to be really analytical and curious. I think all too often people think about marketing and branding as all this stuff that you study. Advertising, and it's fun and exciting and clever, it makes you laugh. But all the work that actually goes into what developed that actual ad is quite a lot of analytical work around the marketplace, sales numbers, profitability, pricing, all sorts of information that comes from lots and lots of different places. And being able to decipher through all of that information and not just pull it, but actually turn it into what it means and what do I do about it is a really important skill that I think is the foundation of a good business person and certainly a good marketer. So analytics and being curious to sort of dig and understand is one thing. Second thing is to be super interested in the consumer or the people that use your brand or products. And so whether that's the people that use our Band-Aids or our Neutrogena skincare products or the doctors and nurses who use our sutures, or whoever else it might be that businesses that are buying our products, being really very passionate about the consumer or the people that are the users of your product is super important. And being curious and interested in figuring out, you know, the why behind the what they say and why they do, and attitudes and usage behaviors and all those sorts of things that consumer passion focus is particularly important. So be passionate about the consumer. And last but certainly not least is be a leader. We're looking for people that, especially marketers at J&J and lots of other companies out there, you are really sitting in the center of a really large organization. And you have a whole lot of accountability for all sorts of things that are way out of your control. And so being a leader that people, that sets a really clear vision of, hey, this is where we're going as a brand and as a business, and here's how all of us are working together to actually get to the end point, and being clear about what's expected, how things are going to get done, how to take the ambiguity of situations and turn them into, you know, sort of very clear paths forward, are the leadership skills that are really, really important as a marketer. And so I guess that those would be the three things that I think are really important. And I guess the advice to you guys as you think about the courses that you're in, the work experience that you have, the internships that you will have, as you talk to employers, you know, think about all the ways you can demonstrate those sorts of skills, because that's what we're looking for. We're not looking for people that have had experience building brands before, because most people don't have that experience, and we want to bring you in and teach you how to do that. But being able to speak to, you know, how you're analytical, how you have a real passion for the consumer, how you're a leader, you know, in the activities that you do, and the ways you work in your project teams for courses and things. Those are all really, really important skills that I encourage you to think about in companies, especially, you know, J&J.
Excellent.
Can I just add one more thing on that one?
Sure.
Sorry. The one thing that I've looked for, and, you know, I've hired a lot of Penn Staters in my Beth at Lilly, Mylan, and hopefully now we'll be hiring them at Eagle. But I think the one thing where people get tripped up is the belief that marketing is the center of everything, right? And we talked a lot about the critical nature of the sales, being in sales. But what I will tell you is one thing that I personally really dig for in interviews is the ability to work cross-functionally, because you cannot do it. And this comes back to the leadership point. But I see, that's where I see the biggest trip of people, and especially less experienced folks. The ability, whether like in pharma, you work with regulatory, medical people, finance, manufacturing, so you're working with a lot of people across many different functions. Your ability to share with prospective employers that you've demonstrated the ability to work effectively, I believe is one critical aspect of being in branding or really anything that you choose to do. Because at the end of the day, if you can't show how well you can work with others, you won't be as successful, whether you climb a corporate ladder or you're opening, you know, how many cafes? A few, right? Is your ability to work with others. So that's one thing, a piece of advice I'd give.
I think you really started that off with what Sherry said. And knowing the room that we have here, I mean, we've got incredibly smart young people that are going to have a Penn State diploma soon, and particularly a SMEAL diploma. Building on sort of what Sherry just said, as I like to say in my organization, our organization rolls around not just our culture, but rolls around our operations department. So a lot of people want to come into marketing because marketing is sexy, and I can do social media, and I can do advertising, I can do all these different things. But the reality is the way we pay our bills is through operating. And so we bring everybody through. So if any of you guys are interested in what I'm doing or what anybody else here on the stage is doing, I'm going to tell you that we bring you into operations. Because if you want to come be the next great VP of marketing for me, or you want to come up with the next great strategy for me, you've got to know at the core of what we do. So how I parlay that into recommendation for you is you're going to have the great piece of paper. You're going to have the tremendous experience in learning from these classrooms from the best professors. Get into an organization or an industry that you love and you're genuinely passionate about, and be a little bit less focused on what the exact job is. Make sure that the job is going to allow you to get in, roll up your sleeves, and learn. Because when the employers look in their organization and they say, who's learned cross-departmentally? Who's gotten in and carried the bag, as they say, in pharmaceuticals? Who's done that and made a difference? My first consultant, I was a consultant out of school, my first boss told me, put feathers in your cap. I didn't know what that meant because people didn't wear hats when I was in college. But essentially what he meant is things done. The people that are getting things done at the core of our business are those who are going to move up in the organization. I'll give up the mic.
Okay, we have a few minutes left, and I expect some really hard questions. And let's direct them to a specific individual so we can make that happen. Okay, we've got a question. What is your name?
Devam.
And where are you from?
India.
Okay, who's your question for?
So my question is for Lee, that what challenges do you face regularly when you create a branding strategy or any kind of strategy?
I don't think we have time to fully answer that question.
question.
You know, I think, we could sit around and talk about strategy for forever, right? Because at the end of the day, strategy is about making a choice. And the fun thing about marketing is that there's endless opportunities and there is endless different directions that we could go. And there's not a, it's unlike mathematics or engineering where there sort of is a right way to get to a final answer that's either correct or incorrect. And if you can do the math problem really well, you did it right. When it comes to making a strategic choice of should we, you know, prioritize expanding our business in India, or should we, you know, prioritize spending the money that we have today and developing this new product that's going to serve a developed market that we have. I mean, you know, there are the pros and cons to all of those things. So being able to simplify down really complex problems and choices into things that are manageable to sort of wrap your head around, to be able to build a compelling case for why to go a particular direction, and then actually rally the rest of the organization around that direction is one of the biggest challenges that we face, given how big we are and how many competing priorities there are, and how many markets that we're in, and how many different need states that we're in, how many brands we have, is that there's so much complexity that at the core we have to really simplify down choices that we make to be able to make them manageable so we can make a clear choice, not sort of make half-assed choices on certain things and be unfocused in where we're going to go. So that's sort of a broad answer, but hopefully that answers your question.
What is your name?
My name's Rob.
And I don't know that yet. Where are you from?
I'm from Yardley. It's right on the border of New Jersey and Pennsylvania.
Yeah, so you're an Eagles fan, right?
Yes, I am.
Oh, right, good. Okay, who's your question for?
My question's for you. And it's really, you talked about your core values, your mission statement earlier. When it comes down to the day at Zaxby's, who or what determines whether the next piece, the next thing you're adding, fits into your brand?
Yeah, it's a great question. Again, a hard one to answer in a minute or two, but and sort of going back to what the culture of the organization is, we're very into entrepreneurship. So I'm an adjunct professor at Drexel teaching entrepreneurship. I've been teaching entrepreneurship at Mile and Modern Cornell for 5 or 6 years now. Entrepreneurship is what we believe in, and it's not an organization where there's an entrepreneur at the top and a lot of people that just sort of follow the entrepreneur. It's the complete opposite. It's an organization of entrepreneurial people, and it's just core to who we are as a culture. So in order for us to be able to innovate things from a product perspective, from a marketing perspective, and put it to market, as an entrepreneurial organization, you've got to ensure that people are aligned with your culture. They're doing the research to know what your consumer wants or doesn't want, or what your competitors are doing or not doing. And then you've got to be able to get out of their way and allow them to actually do. And I get the benefit of that. I'm a much smaller company than a J&J or a Unilever. And that's, yeah, the thing that keeps me up at night is, what happens if we're blessed enough to continue to grow and become a $300 million company, a $1 billion company? Can we stay that entrepreneurial? But I think one of the reasons why we're able to grow and we're able to differentiate is that we are incredibly entrepreneurial. And therefore, we hire people that come to operations, have an interest in marketing or branding, and we give them the opportunity to be able to run with our culture and make decisions in the organization to be able to impact our brand.
Okay, we have time for one more question because I'm getting like the music, like the baby having noise. And also say the hell with that. What is your name?
Mm-hmm. Sam.
Sam, and
yeah.
Where are you from?
New Jersey. Central Jersey, anyone's from there.
And you like Eagles, Jets, Giants?
Giants.
Who else has a question over there? Okay.
Yeah, sorry. I actually have a question for you. So I know for the co-op program for
Johnson
& Johnson, there are two different ones, the sales leadership and the and the consumer branding internship. What are the two different characteristics that you look for for possible candidates for those two? Like, what would separate you from
them? I'll just repeat the question so everybody can hear it.
Yeah.
So, what was your name, Sam?
Sam.
Sam was asking, there's two different types of co-op experiences at J&J. One's in the sales organization, one's in the marketing organization. I'd say, frankly, I think if someone from the sales organization was going to be here and have been in the sales organization, I probably would have listed the same three things as things that are important in terms of what we're looking for. I think the sort of experience that you get is a little bit different, obviously. Sales and marketing work super close together, so you get great experience sort of on the branding side as well as on the customer side. In the sales roles, you're going to have more interaction with either the field sales organization and or the actual customer, the retailers who actually stock our products. Get some great experience on sort of that rubber meeting the road executional elements of how promotions get put in place, how we sell a new item, all those sorts of things, versus on the marketing, you'll work cross-functionally with the marketers. And on the marketing side, you'll spend a lot more time around a particular brand, a particular franchise, lots of all the different elements of the marketing mix to actually build that brand, the strategy behind it, but then obviously work cross-functionally with the sales team to make sure it's implemented in a really successful way.
Boy, that hour went quick. And I understood all of my writing and my note cards still. I want to thank everybody for agreeing to do this back in April and May, showing up on time, answering the questions. I think there's 104, 106 students here. I think it was great. I think we have a first in a series to move forward. I learned stuff. We're going to have an hour tour on top of the terrace at the Smeal Building as soon as we break from here. And they've all agreed to come back at 10 o'clock tonight for another hour's worth of questions.
Maybe Timmy has.
I have nothing else to say. Okay.